For the new Legend of Zelda game to be released, I thought it would be a good idea to talk about a new way to play the legendary hero. Zelda Classic is not exactly a hacked ROM like you may be thinking, but it is a full-blown recreation of the popular Nintendo game. In addition to playing the original Legend of Zelda game, this also comes bundled with a level editor for both the overworld and underworld. I know you're excited, so check it out.
Not only can you alter levels, but items, weapons, enemies, and hey, you can even come up with your own mazes and puzzles for other players to enjoy. You can also decide on the original graphics or see how good the enhanced graphics are. Anything within the realms of 8-bit color are possible, and the only limit is your imagination. Even go as far as changing the messages of the characters you meet along the way, such as the merchants and other helpful people in the game. As of now, there are over 200 different quests that have been submitted to the programmers. Some are 10 times more difficult than the first adventure, and here are some of the quests that have been made so far and are available at the following site. With the promise of major improvements in the program itself, and more quests to be added to the database, this is shaping up to be one hell of a game, and no longer a mere clone.
What's this sign say? It says, that's Jack Din's house. That's my house! Well, welcome to my house and the messy game room once again, folks. Today I'm going to be talking about a little device that will allow you to play your original Famicom game cartridges on your Game Boy Advance or your Game Boy Advance SP. Now, how can you get this cartridge to play on this machine with this? You can't. That's why I'm here to tell you how to do it. Stick around.
So what are you going to need to play these on this? On this? You're going to need the Adofami from GameTech, also known as the 8-bit cartridge adapter for the Advance or the SP. Now check this guy out. The box is big. And it's not small. This guy is a pain in the ass. So what are we going to need to play games on the Adofami? Well, we're going to need the Adofami itself. We're going to need 4 AA batteries. We're going to need an Advance or SP cartridge. The Advance or SP itself, and a Famicom cartridge. Okay, so how do you put all this together to get it all to work? I'll show you. Take the Adofami, the game cartridge adapter, turn it over, open up the battery wings, slip in your batteries, shove them in, pop them over, lock them, flip it over, let's put in the cartridge itself, which would go this way. Slide that little bugger in, like so. Make sure it's in there. It moves around a little bit, which actually will screw you up when you're playing. But for now, I'll show you how to do this. Then you have to actually put in the Game Boy Advance SP or Advance cartridge, like so. Tight fit. Now flip it over. Let's put the SP on. It just slides right on like this. Like that. Snap it in firmly, make sure we've got good connection. There we go.
Okay, Folks, gameplay on the Ad Family is slow. It's not real-time gameplay. If you're looking for portable gaming, don't buy this. If you are looking for cool stuff to collect, buy it. If you shake it or you accidentally move it, it's going to freeze the game. You will lose a life, you'll lose your saves. Would I recommend this? Only for people who want to collect it. Go on licksang.com, you can find some information about it, but you might not be able to buy it. You might have to import it yourself, or a friend. So, would I say it? Toss it. Toss it. Play Solstice on the real thing. I'm your friendly neighborhood ghost host, Matt, if you don't remember me from the first two episodes. I'm here in my game dungeon today. I'm about to load up a game whose muscular main character loves to kick the crap out of ghosts and goblins. The game in question, He-Man in the Mess. The game in question, Maximo, Ghosts to Glory by Capcom for the PS2. This game is actually a sort of remake of a game called Ghosts and Goblins, which was an arcade and 8-bit game from 1985. Unfortunately for us slackers, this game is just as hard, in my opinion it's harder, than those original games. And boy, hang on to your hats and glasses. The great art and character design of Maximo Ghosts to Glory is brought to us by a famous manga artist in Japan named Susumu Matsushita. Alright, let's start the review then.
Maximo has returned from war only to find that his advisor Achille has turned really evil. The land runs amok with evil dead things just ready and willing to kick your, that is Maximo's, arse. Achille has imprisoned the four sorceresses of the ruling council to four different towers strewn across the land. He's also taken Maximo's bride-to-be, Sophia, to be his own wife. Whoa. Alright, so Maximo's quest now is to rescue the four sorceresses from the four towers, overthrow Achille, take his bride back, and then jump back onto his throne. Wait, folks, that's not the porcelain throne. That's the golden throne of a king. The game is played in a third-person viewpoint with the camera following Maximo. And it actually works for a change, folks. Did someone say Mario 64? Okay. To help you along, there's a whopping amount of special abilities. There's tons of moves and great, great power-ups for you to select and customize for the most haunting and daunting ghost and zombie slasher that I've ever seen. In Ghosts to Glory, there's five main worlds, and each of those worlds is made up of about six levels each, including boss levels. If you happen to lose all your lives during the course of a level, you'll be revived by, none less, the Grim Reaper. But he won't take you to the underworld unless you can bribe him with a few death coins. Yes, I said death coins. Maximo will encounter a huge array of enemies, from zombies to black knights, ghosts, skeletons, pirates, snowmen, birds, alligators, lions, tigers, bears, oh my! All in that order, mind you. During your adventures, Maximo might be magically transformed into either a baby with a rattle, an old man that can do handstands on his sword, or a zombie which will reverse all your directional controls, making you go wonky. Yes, I said wonky. Controlling Maximo is done using the left analog joystick and by pushing it further and further off center. That will get him to move faster and faster. He can jump, he can double jump, just like our little plumber friend in the red hat. Your main weapon is Maximo's sword, which can be enhanced with various power-ups, and believe me, you want power-ups for the sword. His shield is also of great value when you block attacks with it, although it will eventually wear out and be rendered useless until you go buy or find another one. There are plenty of goodies to get and collect in this game, folks. Anywhere from gold coins to death coins to potions for healing to catching spirits that emerge from breaking the spirit stones. There's so many abilities and upgrades for your sword, your shield, and your armor that I can't even start to talk about them all. Just believe me when I say, folks, they rock Hell City. This game is beautifully rendered. Everything from the character animation to the lands that you're exploring, you will be awed. Somehow the whole package just draws you in and makes you feel goosebumps all over. The music in the game is superb, and it really draws you in appropriately. You feel like you're really there. The sound effects are great, and they add just the right touch to the overall gameplay and to the atmosphere. You'll love it. Okay, as for the level of challenge you'll face, folks, you might as well pull off your pants, bend over, because this game will have its way with you aplenty. I pretty much reverted to my tantrum-throwing days while playing this game. Maximo's attack time is horrendously slow, leaving precious moments of open season on his ass while you have to wait to attack again. I swear, once you slash once, you have to wait for what seems an eternity for him to recover for a second swing at an enemy. Getting stuck between multiple baddies is a huge mistake and will cost you not only valuable shield and armor, but most likely your life as well.
To be perfectly honest with you people, I haven't played Maximo Ghosts of Glory all the way through yet. Although with that said, I have to say, this is a keeper. Keep it, play it, love it. Maximo will do the same for you and your family, generations to come. Alright, this is Matt, signing off. Until next time, keep it ghosty!
It's become a bit of lore around here that making movies out of video games is a bad idea. And in a lot of cases, the same applies to movies being made into games. Whether or not the movie or game in question was a success, it's hard to translate one into the other without failing miserably. The following example came onto the Super Nintendo in 1991, based on the hit movie Home Alone. I'm smelling a Christmas theme here. The Super Nintendo version of Home Alone finds a 16-bit Macaulay Culkin in a quest to protect the family values from a 16-bit Joe Pesci and Daniel Stern, otherwise known as the Wet Bandits. But it looks like they called in some reinforcements that were not in the film, like Sherlock Holmes here. The game has four levels, which is supposed to be the McAllister house. Do you recall giant toy soldiers in the movie? In each level, you are to gather certain valuable items and drop them into the laundry chute into the basement, where apparently there's a huge vault, which might have been in the film, we just didn't see it. The first level, you're finding jewelry and cash. Okay, that's normal. You'll want to keep that away from burglars. But who hides sacks of cash in the toilet? But then when you're collecting toys and clock radios that blink 12 o'clock when they're not plugged into a f***ing socket, things start to get a little weird. I don't give a crap if this is a game. Who keeps 35 rare pets around the house? And since when are cats and dogs considered rare in the first place? Home Alone has very little in common with the game. The fun of springing traps is nowhere to be found in this game because the traps are already laid out and you can get hurt on them yourself. But when the burglars step on one, is he throwing up? They make funny noises when you shoot at them with your water pistol too. Well gee, didn't know you can hurt someone by shooting them with room temperature unfiltered tap water from the bathroom sink! Maybe I'll break out my super soaker sometime and use it on my neighbors. Meantime, let's continue the review to this god-awful movie-to-game conversion. The graphics feature some grainy, digitized stills from the movie. Most of them are supposed to help the game's story along. Odds are you won't care for the story and just skip to the action, or skip the game entirely. The only character that looks good as 16-bit is Daniel Stern's character. And who are all these other fellas you meet in the many rooms of the house? I guess it was thought that having only two villains would not be enough to keep a little kid busy. Even though in the basement parts of the game you have to deal with mice, bats, ghosts, and spiders. Even giant ones as boss characters, and I'm sorry to say the spider looks horribly detailed when it's big. Moving on to the sound. You will hear the famous Kevin scream when he loses a life in the game. And some pretty hokey sound effects. And let's not forget this. Music has a nice beat at first, but then loops continuously, causing you to fumble for your remote looking for the mute button. Some of the tunes sound like 16-bit renditions of the Nutcracker Suite, or maybe music that could have been inserted into a Ren and Stimpy game. I haven't that much to say about the control. It's decent enough, but there will be times that you'll miss when jumping over one of the burglars after being hit with that deadly water you're packing.
Can't complain much about moving Kevin around. The difficulty of Home Alone will make you wonder why there are no passwords or save features, but one continue throughout the whole game. You begin with 3 lives and can collect extra ones by finding pizza slices. You can pick up weapons like baseballs, slingshots, and rifles, but you'll mainly use the water gun most of the time. I wish the game relied more on the traps and less emphasis on finding these ridiculous family treasures. And I doubt this game will be considered a family treasure. If it is still selling on the internet, you can always give it to someone you don't like this holiday.
Home Alone. Great movie, bad game. Toss it. You disagree? I will fill you full of dangerous hot water. It may not be Poland Spring or Dasani, but it'll hurt you pretty bad. Yeah. Just when you thought this segment would only bring you superhero short films and old movie serials, I spring the 80s on ya. Now, the 1980s had a share of good and bad animated movies, and thankfully, you won't have to sit through me reviewing the likes of Rainbow Bright or Care Bears. You're welcome. Actually, today I'm going to be reviewing G.I. Joe the Movie, released in 1987, but not as a theatrical release. It was only released on video, however, the Transformers got into the theaters. Go figure. I like them both.
If you're one of those 80s toy fanatics who own every single action figure and vehicle of G.I. Joe and Cobra, and have enjoyed the regular animated series since its debut in 1983, then you'll go for this movie for sure. In the end, I didn't really hate this movie, I just thought it was worth looking at. The story is as follows. Serpentor is hatching a plan to steal a broadcast energy transmitter from the Joes, and along with Cobra's new ally, Globulus, plot to turn the world into mutants using this machine. Right from the beginning, you have to sit through a 3-minute opening sequence, which kind of feels more like a music video. Does give you goosebumps if you're a sucker for 80s cartoons, though I personally could have done with something a little bit shorter. You'll also take notice of some big-name talent alongside the regular cast of G.I. Joe. Don Johnson of Miami Vice fame plays Lieutenant Falcon, Duke's half-brother. Burgess Meredith, yeah. He's playing Globulus. And of course, where would a G.I. Joe adventure be without Sergeant Slaughter, huh? He's playing himself.
My name is Sergeant Slaughter, special drill instructor for G.I. Joe.
During the film, you'll witness a lot of events, such as what Cobra Commander used to look like and what he'll look like later on. Now, unfortunately, if you're a huge fan of the G.I. Joe series, you're going to notice a few things here. First is the silent characters who normally have a voice in the regular series. I can understand too many voices is a bit nuts and will make the movie hard to follow if you have to keep track of each character in here, but it's nice to have them make an appearance anyway, even if they're just there for show. No big deal. Now, the addition of new characters didn't quite sit right with me, particularly this fellow who has to add sports commentary on nearly every damn thing he does. I just think the others were there for filler, I'm sorry to say. Now, the story was pretty good, with a great scene involving Duke when he... Alright, I know. I'm doing it again, spoiling it for those who haven't seen the film. I'm sorry. I can safely say, if you haven't yet taken a look at this film, go ahead and at least rent it from Blockbuster or wherever and give it a go. It's gotta be better than the G.I. Joe series they got on now.
There, you see? No superhero films in this episode. Just great heroes that made great toys that are now selling for an entire paycheck on eBay. It's true. Now, there aren't any links I can give you for this movie as far as downloading it as one of those torrent files or whatever. You'll have to spend money for this one, but I do think it's worth a couple of bucks to either rent it or pick it up at the next yard sale. It's good stuff.
Marvel Comics has always brought you the best superheroes to ever appear on print, and somehow managed to either tweak a character's origin when converting it to television or film, or just completely overhaul it. Sometimes it works, sometimes it doesn't. In the case of the Invincible Iron Man on DVD, mind you, I haven't really read the origin in the comic books, so I don't really know how accurate this is, So I'm not here to compare, bitch, and moan, well, that's not how it happened in the comics. This is a movie review. We're here to review it, so let's begin. Iron Man on DVD. Stark Enterprises is hard at work attempting to raise an ancient Chinese temple using advanced modern technology, unaware of the disastrous consequences if they do so. You see, once the temple is raised, it will bring forth four elementals. Earth, wind, fire, yeah, I think you know the rest. Their purpose now is to find powerful rings that will resurrect a fella called the Mandarin. Now, I'm sure you've all heard of the Mandarin already. Now, let's just say that once he's reborn, things are gonna change. So now it falls to Iron Man, otherwise known as Tony Stark, to prevent Mandarin from creating mischief on a global scale. Before I go any further, I know I have a track record for giving away endings to these movies, but after seeing the twist toward the end, I ain't spoiling it. I've become quite involved with the story and the characters, and while I'm not all that familiar with the Iron Man mythos outside his animated appearances over the years, I was very interested in how the story was moving along and how the characters were set up. The whole film has got great voice acting, and I was able to identify the voice of Jim Rhodes as the voice of Robbie Robertson on the Spider-Man animated series of the 90s.
Remember when your father took your stuff and put it into his weapons program? How betrayed you felt?
All other voices I haven't heard in that many places, but they certainly do bring their character's personality to life. There's lots of action, and your friend and mine does make a pretty good entrance, so just be patient. I won't tell you when or where you'll see him, but whether or not you're a faithful comic book reader, you're gonna have a good time watching this film from start to finish.
TK-421. You're wanted in the detention center immediately. Hey guys, how you doing? Today I would like to review a Nintendo 64 game called Tsumitobatsu Chikyu no Keishosha, which in English means Sin and Punishment, Successor of the Earth. Now this is a Japanese import game only. You can probably find it at your local import store, or you can go to Japan and find it. I found this after searching 2 days in Akiba. It costs about 680 yen. It was zipped up in a little Ziploc bag with no manual and no case or whatnot, just this. Recently, and interestingly enough, Nintendo released this game in China on the iQ in 2004. You can search on that later. If you want to play this on your Nintendo 64, if you do not have a Japanese system, you're going to need a universal adapter like this. I recently found one on PlayAsia.com for about 20 bucks, and as of yesterday, it was in stock. I found this in Japan for like 200 yen about 10 years ago. It's a piece of junk, but it works. All right, let's start the review.
Playing Sin and Punishment makes me kind of feel like I'm playing a really old-style arcade game. Like I'm in an arcade with my friends standing around me shouting and screaming and throwing Coke in my face and making me mess up and die and lose quarters. Hey guys, shut up! The story of the game is quite confusing even when you're playing it, and having it translated from the original Japanese is no less confusing. But here we go anyway. It's a new century. Mankind is on the verge of destitution. They're all poor and hungry. Along comes science. They made the Rufians, a new being which is the new life body, to feed the population. Unfortunately, things went awry, and the Rufians turned on humanity and started eating their hunters. So now humans, the hunters, are now the hunted. Arose the armed volunteer forces to subdue the people that started rioting because of the Rufian invasion. Now, this game takes place mainly in Japan, where your little group of freedom fighters led by Achi are trying to not only subdue the Rufians, which the armed forces are not doing, but they're also trying to evade the armed forces, which are hunting them for no good reason, it seems. In the game, there's 10 short levels, and that's one of the gripes I've heard from people. It's a little short, but the levels are intense, action-packed, and you might like it. There is no character selection. As I said, you play Iron Joe throughout the whole game. Her weapon of choice is the gun sword. It's a G&R M64 JPC Dolphin Police Standard. The gun function lets you either choose a lock-on section or
You can free roam the cursor to try to lock on to enemies yourself. Personally, I like the lock-on function because you get the cursor a little close to an enemy and it locks and stays there until it's defeated. Bosses in the game, there's only about, I think, 3 bosses. I haven't played the whole game all the way through, as it's too difficult for me. My hands hurt. I'm old. Sorry. But the bosses were quite intense, and unfortunately I never beat the bosses. C'est la vie. This is a rail-on shooter, and you're always a little bit behind and above your character. The graphics of the game are fast, colorful, lots of explosions, lots of eye candy. Sometimes it's actually a little confusing to see what you're supposed to be looking at and shooting at. As for sound and music in the game, it all fits perfectly, draws you in. You get scared when you're supposed to, and you laugh when you are supposed to, and you cry when you're supposed to. Controlling your character is a little daunting at first. It takes some practice. Once you get used to it, it's fine, but like I said, be prepared to spend some time learning the controls. As for gameplay, well, since this is a rail-on shooter, you're guided where you're supposed to go. You have control. You can go left and right a little bit. You can jump. Of course, aim your cursor around the screen. There's 2 different locking mechanisms. Firing mechanisms, I should say. One, you can lock onto the nearest object from the cursor. Or the other way is you can just freestyle it and hope you hit something. Good luck there. The stage design of all the levels are superb. Thank you, Treasure. Sometimes you won't know exactly what to shoot, and you sometimes won't know that you can shoot objects for maybe some bonuses or whatnot. Sometimes things come screaming at you from all angles. Gets confusing, but it's really lovely, and one of the great little things in this game, if a ruffian or an armed volunteer guy comes close to you, you can do a sword slash, which will render them unconscious and bubbly.
Okay, so there's the story in the review, and you saw some nice gameplay elements of it. What do you think? Go on to our forums, listed right here, somewhere right around in here, I think. Go on to the forums, tell us what you think of the game, or what you think of my crappy review. What do I say, though? I say try it. Try Sin and Punishment, Successor of the Earth. There you go. See you next time. Bye-bye.